Former Quezon City Mayor Herbert Bautista and former City Administrator Aldrin Cuna plead not guilty in a graft case they are facing before the Sandigambayan. Robert Manona joins us with details. Hi, Robert. Go ahead.
Standi, accompanied by their legal counsels, the former Quezon City Mayor Herbert Bautista and former City Administrator Aldrin Cuna pleaded not guilty before the Sandigambayan 7th Division. Both Bautista and Cuna are facing graft case on the alleged release of full payment of 32.1 million pesos to an IT firm for the procurement of online occupation permitting and tracking system. Bautista supposedly entered into a contract with the firm and approved the release of the full payment despite the absence of a specific appropriation ordinance enacted by the Sangguniang Panglungsod. Before the arraignment, the Council of Cuna requested that the arraignment be postponed because they have pending motion to quash. But it was dismissed outright because the prosecution did not receive the copy of the motion. The motion to postpone the arraignment was not also granted. Before the arraignment, the court proceeded with a pre-trial. According to the prosecution, they will present 31 witnesses. Meanwhile, Bautista said the case was politically motivated but refused to further discuss his allegations. And that's the latest from Sandigambayan, Sandy.
All right. Thank you so much for the update, Robert Mano. Persecution and not prosecution. That's how the camp of suspended lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. called the filing of murder complaints against him over the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo. His lawyer, Ferdinand Topacio, adds a possible arrest warrant won't force Teves to return to the Philippines, citing his right to self-preservation. Teves has been overseas since March, refusing to come home due to what he called serious threats to his life.
But your intention is not to evade the processes of the court, but to secure yourself. Self-defense is a recognized right. The right to keep oneself out of danger is a recognized right even by the Constitution and the Supreme Court. Paano kami makaka-assure ng fairness kung ngayon pa lang yung mismong hepe at yung boss ng mga mag-determine kung may probable cause, sinasabi ng siya ang mastermind, malakas ang ebidensya. Those are the cards that we have been dealt with at talagang tagilid kami dahil bias ang Secretary of Justice.
As for the widow of Governor Degamo, Pamplona Mayor Janice Degamo believes they have a solid case against Teves. She also vows to continue pushing for Teves' expulsion from Congress after a House panel rejected her request, citing lack of form and content.
We might explore another avenue to have him expelled, like the angle on gambling. I think the reason why Congressman Arnie wouldn't confirm nor deny whether or not he seek asylum in another country was because for fear that it might really be the reason that he will be expelled. So I will be very happy if Congress will pursue that. And not just me, along with me are hundreds and maybe thousands others from Negros Oriental who would love to see him expelled from work.
President Marcos has signed into law a measure that amends the fixed terms of ranking officials of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Now, Pia Gutierrez joins us with that story. Hi, Pia. What can you tell us?
Yes, that's right. Stanley, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has approved amendments in the AFP fixed term law. Republic Act number 11939, signed by that on Wednesday, amends RA-11709. This was the earlier measure signed by Marcos Jr.'s predecessor, former President Rodrigo Duterte, in 2022, which set fixed terms for the highest military positions. Now, under the new law, only the AFP chief of staff will have a maximum tour of duty of 3 years unless he or she is sooner terminated by the president. Meanwhile, the chiefs of the Philippine Army, the Philippine Air Force, and the Philippine Navy, including the superintendent of the Philippine Military Academy, will now only have a maximum tour of duty of 2 years unless sooner terminated by the president. These officials would also not be eligible for any post in the AFP unless they are promoted to chief of staff. And instead of 56 years old, the law now sets the age of compulsory retirement to 57 years old for enlisted military personnel as well as officers with the ranks of second lieutenant or ensign in the Navy to lieutenant general or vice admiral in the Navy, or after they have rendered 30 years of active duty in the AFP, whichever comes later. Meanwhile, those commissioned under Presidential Decree Number 1908 and those appointed in the Corps of Professors in the AFP will have a compulsory retirement age of 60 years old. The law also increases the maximum tenure in grade for military officers with the rank of Brigadier General or Commodore from 3 years to 5 years, as well as those for those with the rank of Colonel or Captain from 8 years to 10 years. Stanley, the amendments to the fixed-term law comes amid reports of supposed grumblings in the military leadership over what DNDOIC Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr. earlier called as the unintended consequences of the measure, which was originally meant to resolve the revolving door policy in the armed forces of the Philippines. Stanley?
All right. We know there have been discussions about this, Pia, at its onset a few years back. Now it is signed into law. Are you still hearing opposition or perhaps even dissenting opinion on the move?
Not yet, Stanley. I've said that the law was signed only on Wednesday or signed only yesterday, and we have yet to hear reactions coming from the AFP leadership over this new law.
All right. Thank you so much for the update, Pia Gutierrez. Three projects in Palawan under the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, or EDCA, with the U.S. already completed. Facilities including ammunition storage, command and control fusion, and an above-ground fuel tank have been built in the Antonio Bautista Air Base, which is an existing EDCA site in Puerto Princesa. The construction of an air base on Balabac Island, one of the four additional EDCA sites in the country, is also underway.
We're looking na matapos ito as soon as we can. Dahil the time is of the essence. Alam naman natin na we have to fast track. Na-decide din lang ito na it will be one of the EDCA sites. Diba? So there will be planning. May mga plano pa na kung ano talaga ang mag-consaksas pa. But for the meantime, ito government funded projects muna yung ginagawa natin. Because hindi lang naman sa atin yan. Ang atin, pag-i-decide pa nga eh. And sa side naman ng counterparts, dami ding mga procedures that they have to follow. Kasi subject to approval.
China weighs in on ownership concerns, hounding the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines, which is 40% owned by Chinese investors. China says it supports Chinese companies in carrying out practical cooperation in the Philippines in accordance with laws. China's remark comes as President Marcos agreed to a comprehensive study on NGCP amid recent power interruptions and an alleged security breach. The Philippine government also vows to take back the entity if necessary. The NGCP told senators in a hearing, Filipinos still control the operations, citing the 60% share of Philippine corporations. Prime Infra Chairman Enrique Razon hits back at the critic of the Malampaya contract extension. Razon points out former Philippine National Oil Company President Eduardo Manyalak is not in a position to push for the state's reacquisition of the gas project. That's as he claims Manyalak has a questionable history of attempting to compromise Philippine territory. Razon was referring to an agreement brokered by Manyalak for joint marine seismic undertaking with Vietnam and China in the West Philippine Sea. Manyalak has argued the Malampaya project may cause losses for the government. Aside from Manyalak, environmental group Greenpeace is also opposed to the renewal of the contract.
Within this contract, aside from extending existing Malampaya exploration facility, it will have three exploration sites with an estimated of 5 billion each. No? But there's no guarantee that we will have an additional source of gas in this contract. So this is quite risky for the side of the government or even the contractors, no? Because there's no assurance that there will be an additional capacity from the existing facility, which has only around with an estimated 210 billion cubic feet of remaining deposit. So that means, based on the estimate of Department of Energy, it will last until probably around 2027. But there's another study that have shown that we only have around until next year in terms of the supply of Malampaya.
The Marcos administration looking to revive the Philippine Sugar Corporation to boost the commodity's production and strengthen the industry. That government-owned and controlled corporation was abolished in 2018 due to supposed overlapping functions with the Sugar Regulatory Administration. But after meeting with sugar industry stakeholders, Marcos believes farmers need the services of PhilSugCorp. The agency was formed in 1983 to provide funding for the acquisition and rehabilitation of sugar mills.
It provides a, it's financing for farmers, especially for cooperatives and farmers associations, yung mga tinatawag na block. Ngayon, hindi masyado silang nakakapagtrabaho dahil they tried to abolish the PhilSugCorp in 2019, I think. Ngunit hindi na-abolish, nandiyan pa sila. Kaya bubuhayin natin at babaguhin natin, titignan natin kung ano yung mga pagbabago para makapag-adjust tayo dito sa sitwasyon natin ngayon.
Marcos, the concurrent agriculture secretary, also bared more details about government's planned importation of 150,000 metric tons of sugar.
We agreed on an importation schedule and how we will open up the importation to all of the traders. In the end, we will still continue to favor, in terms of buying, local production over importation.
On to another commodity supply concern. Government is considering importing some 8,000 metric tons of white onions this year to stabilize prices. The Agriculture Department estimates the country has nearly 13,000 metric tons of white onions as of April, which will last until September. Stocks of red onions, meanwhile, are estimated to be at 98,400 metric tons. That is enough until November. Now, the agency says the target is to have 2 months' worth of buffer stock. Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo, meanwhile, is urging law enforcement agencies to look at a possible cartel in the industry.
At the core of this is an onion cartel theory, which is really about the Philippine Vieva group of companies, a fully vertically integrated corporation, an SEC registered corporation established in 2013. Its incorporators are corporations that are involved in local trading, importation, cold storage, warehousing, and trucking. Its majority owner, who appears to be Lilia or Lea Cruz, also described the corporation as involved in the farming of vegetables. Sa madaling salita, Mr. Chair, hawak sa leeg ng PhilVieva ang buong supply chain mula umpisa, which is farming, hanggang dulo, which is logistics. Sorry, which is retail.
The Masungi GeoReserve Foundation insists its forest conservation deal with the Philippine Environment Department is above board. The group adds it remains open to talks with government on the agreement, which some DENR officials want scrapped over supposed unconstitutional provisions.
The setback, the conservation movement in the country, this should not even be an issue that is, you know, discussed to this extent. Our position that it is not unconstitutional, if a competent court determines that it is, so we will not oppose it. We're open to discussing a term. That would be a proper forum for it. We're also, of course, open to convening an oversight now, which we have also been requesting for several years now, to speak with DNR in good faith.
The Justice Department, meanwhile, maintains the constitutionality of the agreement is questionable. The agency also asserted its position on the matter is not connected with its earlier plan to build either a penitentiary or the main office of the Bureau of Corrections in the protected area.
This is a whole government approach. It's not one department trying to do one thing in order to promote its own selfish interest. No, we are here to protect the environment. The area that it was intended by the Bucor to be utilized as its head office, just to address that directly, it's not the entirety of the Masungi-Jeyo Reserve. It's not. It's just a small portion of it. We don't see any conflict at all. Instead, this is a joint effort. It's an all-government effort to protect the environment. And we are simply putting some strength or some flesh to the authority of the DNR to exercise its regulatory monitoring or oversight functions over Masungi-Jeyo Reserve Foundation, Inc.